Check, check. Good morning, everyone. I want to welcome each of you here. I want to welcome those of you who are watching online today. You're here for what we call a memorial service, and we are going to do that today. But my hope is that by the time you leave, you will feel that we have celebrated a life, celebrated Jerry's life. A great celebration is worthy of this time. A loving husband and leader to Ella Mae, a patriarchal figure to Jerry's whole family, and a pillar in this church. Jerry was a unifier. Jerry had that ability to bring people together, as by your presence today. And so we want to celebrate his life. I want to say today, before we go any farther, that while we're celebrating this life, Jerry would not be the man that he is without the wife that he had. Ella Mae, you go hand in hand with Jerry. And we love you, and we acknowledge that all that he was is due partly because of your love and your relationship as a couple. Will you pray with me as we begin? Heavenly Father, we thank you for your gifts. Thank you first for Jesus, who is the ultimate unifier, who brings people together. And Father, today we want to celebrate this life, Jerry, whose faith was in Jesus and who was one of your children. Unique. Lord, we want to celebrate well today. I'm confident we're going to hear many things in this next hour. And so, Father, we invite your presence. We ask that you would give us that spirit of joy for the victorious occasion that this is. For Jesus' sake, amen.
Good morning, and I just wanted to say on behalf of my family, thank you for coming here today. This is a celebration, and all of you have had a connection with my dad in some way. Some of you who may be a little bit older, he may have been your pastor, maybe an early. For some of you, maybe you were here at the church and he taught a Bible study or a Sunday school class. Maybe you've come over to my mom and dad's house, and he's prayed with you, he's opened the Bible, you've talked, you've needed somebody to listen, and or maybe you've come over for dinner and had a dinner that my mom and dad have prepared. Maybe a work colleague, maybe he was your work colleague. Whatever the reason, we are glad you're here. Thank you for coming to celebrate my father's life. And as we all know, it is here, and he wants us to honor the Lord because that's what his life was about. The other thing I wanted to do is to say thank you. Thank you for serving. Thank you for serving my mom and dad over the years. And as I think about it, I think about the very first time my dad had emergency open heart surgery, and the people that immediately came. And I remember walking out one time, and as I was walking past the chapel there at the hospital, people leaving, and they were there praying for my father and praying for my family, and that really made an impression. But the other thing is that all the subsequent hospital visits and so on, people continued to serve, and we want to say thank you. When you serve my parents, you're not just serving them, you're serving us as a family. And for those people, for us who couldn't be here, we were comforted with the knowledge that my mom and dad were being served. The other thing that was really wonderful is that it was a variety of ways. People were so creative. And some of the things that people would do were, maybe they, of course, brought a meal. But then it was more than that. It was a card, a verse, a phone call, a call to say, Jerry, I'm coming over and I'm going to take you on a ride. Let's go for a ride. It was, Jerry, we need to go out for a burger. Let's go out. Or it was, I'm coming over, I'm going to take you out for coffee. People brought raspberries, homemade, freshly baked bread, flowers, a beautiful basket. So many ways in which the body has continued to serve. And you know, my parents would tell me these things over the years as Dad's health improved, and then he was struggling again, and then he would get better. Your kindness and your love in serving us not only served my mom and dad, but it served us. It served us knowing that they were so cared for and so loved. And what a great example, not only for me to act upon my good intentions of serving, but for my children to hear about the stories of how people have come alongside my parents and served them. Not because it was a checklist, because you wanted to. And we are forever thankful for what you have done for our family. Thank you.
Testing. Today we remember Jerry Klaudt, a boy from Arlee, in order that we may better worship the God who saved Jerry and enabled him to become the man that we loved. As someone said just yesterday, he was my other father, and we are glad to have shared him with you. Some of you here today have said goodbye to Jerry before, more than once, and the Lord kept bringing him back. And so we thank our friends in the medical community, who, it's a small army by now, for being God's grace to us these 19 additional years, this side of open heart surgery. We praise the Lord for that. Linton, North Dakota, his birthplace. Jerry describes growing up in a brown world, the houses, the fields, the dust. Growing up hearing stories of the grasshopper plague of biblical proportions devouring every green thing. Jerry was the last of 8 children. Times were hard. Dad was drinking, and for mother, the day of Jerry's birth was not a celebration, not a lot of food in the house as it was. But God, in his grace, gave Jerry an open heart, a love for the songs learned in Sunday school. And as a child, he would walk around and around the pastor's house singing these songs to Jesus. In Jerry's words, I loved Jesus before I really knew what it meant to be born again. Once the family had moved to Montana, Jerry also loved Dickey Lake Bible Camp. From its most rustic days, when kids would arrive and stuff the long bags with straw as their sleeping mattresses. God was good. And how many summers then did Jerry and Ella May as a team later serve at Dickey Lake? Jerry got to see also a changed life at home when his father surrendered to Jesus Christ. Jerry helped his dad, who was custodian at Arlee High School. And though his dad lived with regrets, did not really have the vocabulary to describe this striking inner transformation or describe what he felt, Jerry says, he showed me by his desires that the Christian life was the way to go. And there was gospel music. His dad loved Christian music, getting the next record album, driving to a gospel concert anywhere in the vicinity. They often sat, father and son, not saying much at all, listening to gospel music. It was in these years also that older brother Marvin, at age 18, drowned in Kalispell, a devastating loss of the family member Jerry was closest to, who had laid out a spiritual path ahead of Jerry. As a 15-year-old, Jerry did not have parents able to process the grief even for themselves. And Jerry says of that time, you know, there is a tempering quality to suffering and grief, and God can use that. No, he would not undo the death of his brother, for he sees how clearly it was a spiritual pivot point in the life of the family. Do you hear in this God's gracious story of enabling the pains of our lives to shape the heart of a man? Jerry said recently, as I look back, I can see many men I've known who never knew their father's approval. So I made it a point to express. How do these relationships even begin? Well, sometimes it's a simple, we'd like to have you over to the house for dinner. Jerry and Ella May as teammates again. Or, I'd like to take you out for coffee and get to know you better. Our dad was not perfect by any means, but the common denominators for so many of us, young and old, men and women alike, we were not left to doubt that he knew about us, heard us, discerned, did not withhold his approval, spoke a word at the right time, prayed over us. I fully understand the desire of that man who came to Jerry's bedside two, or was it three, hospitalizations ago, thinking it may be a last visit, and said, Jerry, I want you to place both hands on my head and on my face and pray for me. You and I can do that same thing in others' lives. Speak that word from your heart and from the Lord. Don't leave those things unsaid. In recent decades, you may have known Jerry's interest in meat. Meat should be chosen, rubbed, injected with brine, placed in the fridge, marinating for weeks, grilled, shared, eaten, smoked, made into sausage or jerky, and given as Christmas gifts. And sharpen well that knife that you're about to use to cut into that pork shoulder. You may have known of Jerry's interest in plants, in having a sizable garden, poring through seed catalogs in the winter, rotating those starter plants in the sunny front window, providing the bounty that went into their teamwork of canning, preserving, freezing, and giving. Ella Mae, we really should get another box of peaches and another box of pears. You would think our family life revolves only around food. You may have known Jerry on the job site. His attention to detail, his knack for raising large beams into place with unique mechanisms, letting the tool do the work, a project done well. Even this past year, the small 2-foot by 3-foot front closet at their house needed to be stripped down to the studs for better insulation and a vapor barrier on the garage side, reinforced flooring and full cut pieces of sheetrock. You don't just leave your leftover scraps and put those in the closet. Years of practice at gotta keep an eye on those sheetrockers, you know. You may have known Jerry as one not afraid of technology. Just this week, I've heard about a young married man in Mexico to whom Jerry, they've been texting away despite the language barrier. Heard of a man in Kosovo, spiritual son of a spiritual son from Missoula here, connected to Jerry long distance. His phone filled with the record of relationships, social media to the glory of God. Maintaining contact across the time zones with grandchildren who know and feel the texture of his love for them. So all of you, my age and older, Jerry commends to you the joyful ministry of social media. You may have known Jerry as a pastor with builder's hands. In his 20s, there, pastoring in Arlee, one of the men in his congregation faced a crisis in his business, desperately needed a warehouse, so Jerry started building him one, calling others to join in, laboring on it consistently. In his 40s and 50s, Jerry was a builder with a pastor's heart. What do you do when you're facing deadlines, needing to get that box of hardware from the lumber yard back to the job site, heading out the door toward the truck, when the Lord grasps you by the shoulder and turns your attention to the man in the office? The man in the office there through the glass. Well, you pause, you go to him, you ask about his heaviness of heart. You listen, and you share Jesus Christ. Jerry would want you to know Jesus Christ for yourself today, from the inside out, as your only hope. And if you're unsure of what that means, seek someone out here today before you leave the building. You may have known Jerry's love for opening the scriptures or known him as a Bible teacher. Maybe you were there with him in one of those beautifully long series, like from 1 and 2 Samuel or Hebrews. And some of his favorite passages of the scripture for memorizing and meditating were Isaiah 53, Psalm 27, Psalm 34, or Psalm 73, that he referred to as the heart patience psalm. Passages like these, in which he had spent so much of his time, his conscious waking moments, he described as footholds for his mind back to reality during those times when he was coming out of anesthesia. I end with this. Some years ago, there was a knock at their door, and a large man filled the doorway, had to duck in order to enter. Came in and said, "You Jerry Klaudt?" "Yes." "I've been told I can find Jesus here." "Yes, yes, come in. We are ready now to sing and would love to have you join us."
Immortal, invisible, God only wise, in light inaccessible, hid from our eyes. Most blessed, most glorious, the Ancient of Days, Almighty, victorious, thy great name we praise. Unresting, unhasting, and silent as light, nor wanting, nor wasting, thou rulest the night. Thy justice like mountains high soaring above, thy clouds which are fountains of goodness and love. To all life thou givest, to both great and small, in all life thou livest, the true life of all. We blossom and flourish as leaves on a tree, and wither and perish, but not changeth thee. Great Father of glory, pure Father of light, thine angels adore thee, all veiling their sight. All praise we would render, oh help us to see, 'tis only the splendor of light hideth thee.
Good morning. My name is Kate Klaudt, and I am Les Klaudt's daughter, so Grandpa Jerry's granddaughter. And the last time I was up here in front of you all, I was baptized by Grandpa Jerry 7 years ago. So I just thought of that. And I wouldn't want it any other way, having him watch and guide us. My family lived here in Missoula with him for most of our life. So he was a witness to some very special moments for my siblings and I. What I want to share with you guys today is the final words that I wrote to Grandpa, actually in 2015, when we thought that he was passing. And for some reason, I wasn't able to go to Missoula that weekend, so I wrote this letter to be taken to him. And I know he read it, but we never discussed it. And so I keep that in my heart, and I know that Grandpa has it in his heart, so I want to share it with you. So this is from March 19th, 2015. Dear Grandpa Jerry, thank you for being my grandpa. Life looks different for me because, in fact, you are my grandfather. You were there for everything in my childhood, from middle school orchestra concerts to Christmas Eve parties to 4th of July picnics to almost every single birthday dinner. Thank you for being a constant place in my heart that brings a smile to my face and affection to my spirit. Thank you for all the snuggles and hugs that encouraged my affectionate side as I grew up. Thank you for the fond memories of being over at your house and in your garden on a sunny Sunday afternoon. Grandpa, I want you to know that I, Kate, am here for you and love you, even in this phase of trial and true heartache. I want to encourage you to keep your warm smile about you, even when the energy isn't there. Because when you smile and take heart in the face of pain, it is testament of your faith in the Lord and the ultimate destiny he has in store for you. Jesus smiles when you do, Grandpa, because it shows you trust him deeply despite your suffering. I remember when I was maybe 10 years old, and I asked you what your favorite song in the church was. One of us answered, "We will dance on the streets that are golden, the glorious bride and the great Son of Man. For every tongue and tribe and nation will join in the song of the Lamb." We both continued to sing the song together, smiling and waiting for Sunday's brunch to be ready. I don't think I've told you, Grandpa, but in my heart, I glow with a secret pride that you and I had such a special moment of music. And I treasure this memory in my heart. Grandpa, one day you will enter the kingdom of heaven. And I wish with all my might that that day is far away.
But when you do, the Lord will say, well done, my good and faithful servant. And you will finally walk and dance down those streets that are golden. You are a godly man, Grandpa. Your life has proven to me over and over the might, the love, and the truth of God's heart. And I want to say thank you. Love, Katie Ray.
Good morning, everyone. So I'm Kate's twin, so Les's other daughter. And what I have to share this morning are also song lyrics. That seems to be a theme within our family. Songs express the feelings we may not have words for or have words to come up with. So this song I got to share with Grandpa a few years ago. He had been hospitalized, and if you know Grandpa at all, that was his least favorite place to be. I mean, if Grandpa made it to the hospital, he was not really a happy camper. So I coordinated with Grandma, and I got to bring him an ice cream sundae. Caramel was his favorite flavor. And I know he was feeling sick, and it was at the end of a long day, and he just sat up, and he gave me a big smile. And I said, Grandpa, I want to share this with you. And in that hospital room, we celebrated the eternal hope and promise that we have in heaven, despite the trials of this life. So the song is called Press On. For a man who follows Jesus all the days of his life, picks up his cross and walks with God, a glorious inheritance awaits him at the end, where he will see and know his true Father, and the pearl of great price will be in his hand. So as for me, I will press on in running the race, with my eyes fixed on Jesus, who inspires and perfects my faith. I will fight the good fight with all my heart and soul, till the day that I'm with Jesus, the day I'm finally home. He will approach the throne of his Father with Jesus at his side. The Father will rise and say, welcome home. You're a good and faithful servant. Come home and take your reward. The battle is done. Come in and take your rest. Stay with me forevermore. And the heavens will resound with a thunder of praise. The angels and saints will shout with joy. The father will dance, for his son has come home. Another warrior has returned from the fight, another victory for the Lamb of God. So as for me, I will press on in running the race, with my eyes fixed on Jesus, who inspires and perfects my faith. I will fight the good fight with all my heart and soul, till the day that I'm with Jesus, the day I'm finally home. And what an amazing race Grandpa Jerry got to run. His teaching and example of faith is a legacy that everyone who knew him for a long time or a short time got to be a part of, and that's very special. I'm so blessed and thankful for the years I got to spend with Grandpa Jerry, filled with joy and laughter and love. Thank you all.
Just wanted to acknowledge that I think God created us with emotions, and it's a beautiful thing that we can share in tears together. My name is Kristen, and I am Lois's daughter. I've had the privilege of knowing this man fondly as Grandpa Jerry for the past 23 years. I feel immense gratitude to be old enough that I see and value the relationship that we shared, and to be inspired by the significant impact he had on so many other lives. I think of his hands, so big and powerful and strong, and yet gentle and nurturing. His hands outstretched in worship, holding Grandma's hands on walk, laid on a shoulder in prayer, plastering remodel projects, harvesting vegetables, marinating meat, building, planting, molding, caring, loving. Since a young age, I've always felt the fascination at Grandpa's hands. There is something significant and special about the work with his hands. Establish the work of our hands, as Psalm 90 says, and I have seen evidence of his hands so tangibly and spiritually working in the name of the Lord. I've seen God's hands through the life of Jerry Klaudt. I think of teaching, telling stories, taking every opportunity together to engage in conversation of meaning, of significance, and shared experiences. He taught us the use of his white handkerchief, hanky, to our amazement as children, a tissue that you never had to throw away. He would pull it out of his pocket to share with us at just the right time. Teach us how to dehydrate homemade jerky, the value of fresh pot popcorn with lots of seasoning on it, and the surprising refreshment of eating half of a watermelon with a dash of salt and a big fork. I remember on one of his visits as a six-year-old, he came to pick me up from the bus stop after a day of kindergarten. On our walk back to the apartment, we stopped at a patch of marigold flowers by the entrance. He knelt in his blue jeans upon the dirt, and he took one of the flowers tenderly in his hands. Pointing to the roots and the petals. Recalling how God had created plants to reap seeds that would allow new ones to grow someday. That is the first of his lessons in my memory. And in the years since then, he has built upon those lessons and laid the foundation of my life in prayer, as he says. I think of his garden, how he chose his seeds intentionally, planting new flowers, vegetables and fruits in seasoning and season, how symbolic it was that he loved to sow and grow in the garden, in relationships, in his walk with the Lord. He always sought to improve what could be better, learn more that could be known, and take hold of teachable moments. Canning, fruit jam, beef jerky, Klaudt, a few of the tastes and textures of cherished visits to Grandma and Grandpa's each year. Summertime visits included shelling peas, partaking in a variety of rhubarb baked goods, some sort of meat so lovingly prepared by Grandpa on his grill, and running around the yard with cousins after completing his little tasks of pulling weeds or perhaps binding a row of his bean stalks with fabric strips as he had shown us how to do. A jar of black licorice candy would often sit on the counter next to the shelled peanuts. He liked to suck on some honeycomb. He was always chewing on something, always sharing bits and bites of his favorite flavors with those around him. I think of his quick-witted humor. Well, what will they think of next? He would lean back in his armchair often in wonder and amazement at the latest technology. His energetic kids tugging on his arms with some exciting news to share. He would flutter his eyelashes and say, what, with a glimmer in his eyes. Every visit to us in Olympia included the farmer's market on Saturday mornings, always eager to share in those sticks of beef jerky that he would inevitably buy on account of having to sample all the varieties. He got a kick out of treating us to unhealthy snacks that we rarely had. I remember at the local fairgrounds once, after he had gotten a big soft pretzel with lots of salt that he admittedly was forbidden from, he said, well, if you're going to get nauseous on this roller coaster, we may as well get something in your stomach for you to throw up. Each summer, we hoped to compare tan lines, but could never attain even half of the bronze of Grandpa's forearms. I think of Grandpa's prayers that were sermons within themselves, before mealtimes as we've been gathered together as a family, the eloquence of his words of praise and thanksgiving to the Lord for his goodness, his provision, his faithfulness, his abundance, and his grace. You could not know or talk to Jerry without hearing him speak of the Lord. There was no such thing as shallow conversation with him. He would always turn it to that of spiritual significance. And he always had a way of engaging and initiating and taking sincere interest in the lives of his 10 grandchildren, even from far distances, from Arkansas to Mexico to Colorado and Montana. That has impacted each of us in deep and meaningful and lasting ways. I think of his ministry through the years and stories of others who have come to know the Lord through him. How many surgeries and physical struggles that had us all wondering if this was the last time that I would hug Grandpa, if this was the last time he would kiss my cheek with his big lips. Again and again, the Lord would revive him and give us more time with him, saying, I'm not finished with you yet, Jerry. And how evident it was that God had more kingdom work for him here on earth. Grandpa inspired me by the way he was available to the nudging of the Holy Spirit, devoted himself to prayer, to reading scripture, fellowship, and hospitality. He continually shared what the Lord was impressing upon him and his hopes for the future generations of his family. From 1 Peter 1:4, an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade, kept in heaven for you. What a gift he has given me. What an inheritance. The fondest, most poignant memories of visits to Missoula throughout my childhood have been our time at the dinner table together, singing praise over our meals. The most frequent of our songs led by Grandpa Jerry. To God be the glory, great things he hath done. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son and give him the glory, great things he has done.
His love is the theme of my song. His love is the theme of my song. His love is the theme of my song. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed through his infinite mercy, his child and forever I am. His child and forever I am. His child and forever I am.
Good morning. My name is Neil Klaudt. I'm a brother to Jerry. And I want to thank all of you for coming. So many old friends. Is Ben Griffith here somewhere? Yeah, Ben, I appreciate you. Ben did a lot of the work on this building. He put up every one of those panels in the ceiling. And he had a lot of help on the ground, but Ben was up on the high lift and he fastened every one of them. And Dick McKenzie is here too, and he put in a lot of work on this building. And Jerry worked on the building. And we had a great time working together, and the Lord blessed us as we worked, and he guided us through different problems. The basement of this church is setting on four or five different springs of water, and we had to pipe it all out underground. There's pipes that drain into the draw, and God always solved the problems for us. But I want to talk about Jerry. We were brothers in the flesh. We were brothers in the spirit. And I had a great love and respect for Jerry. We shared so many intimate times together. We came from a family of eight, and we grew up in the Depression era of North Dakota, and Al Gore would have had no trouble convincing us of global warming. In the 30s, there was nothing but dust and heat and grasshoppers. And we had very little to eat, I remember at times. Never went hungry. We always managed to shoot a pigeon or something, and we had something to eat. But those were precious years. Our mother was a Christian, and she insisted every Sunday we be in Sunday school. And I remember one summer I didn't have shoes. And I went to Sunday school with overshoes on. I think it was July. And I thought, man, those babies are hot. But my mother made sure we were in Sunday school. And though it didn't mean much to me at that time, it seemed like water off a duck's back. But it did have an impression that I didn't realize, because later in life, those things that I was taught as a child always came back, and God, in his mercy, always reminded me of those things, and they became so very important to me. Jerry and I did a lot of hunting together. You could tell by the pictures, we made tons of sausage. I remember one case, one weekend we went to White Sulphur Springs, and Jerry and I came back with five deer. And I remember we hung them up in my dad's garage, and then we burned up a 50-foot roll of Super 8 film. And we laughed every time we run that film because we had close-ups of the liver and of the heart and of the rib cage and the hind quarters and the front quarters. And later, after we reviewed that film, we thought, man, we must have been crazy. Why did we burn up 50 feet of film on that? I remember one night in Arlee, Montana, when Jerry was pastor there, we took those five deer and we bought a big hog, I mean a big one. And we spent all night cutting that meat up. We had friends and neighbors that came in to help. But it took us all night to do that. Never slept. Early in the morning, we had a smokehouse out at Walcott's place. And we took the meat out there, and I hung it up in the racks, and we smoked it for hours. But it was 300 pounds of sausage. And I remember that morning, they said, well, should we cook a ring just to see how it is? And I says, I don't want any of it. But later, it did taste all right. Before I get to some serious things, I want to tell you about another little hunting expedition we took. All four of us brothers. And of the eight of us children, only three are left. Me, my brother Ray, who's 91 in a rest home with his wife in Clarkston, Washington, and a sister who lives in a rest home in San Jose, California. And we don't get together much anymore because at this age, you don't motate too well. But of the eight, everyone came to know Jesus Christ sooner or later in their lives. And my brother Ray at that rest home in Clarkston, he witnesses everybody that he can get to stop for a few minutes, and he's not ashamed to witness of Christ. And he says, I don't understand why they refuse it. But they do, but that's part of it. Someday they may. And this one weekend, we went to Ronan. Carol and I graduated from Ronan High School. She was a native of Ronan. And west of Ronan was the Round Butte area, and that's where Carol grew up. And my last 2 years of school there, I got to know the area very well because I hunted pheasants almost every weekend when season was open. And so this one weekend, Ray, Herb, Jerry, and I, we drove to Ronan, and we went out to the Remington Estate. And Carol's chuckling. Yeah, but there was a pothole there that usually had some ducks on it. And so we blasted away and got a few ducks. And then we spread out and we start walking across this pasture. And as we got about halfway across this pasture, my brother Herb kept pointing to this culvert that went under a roadway, just a country roadway through this pasture. And I said to Jerry, he was walking next to me, I says, man, I says, we got a rooster cornered in that culvert. So Herb kept pointing to the culvert, so we got over to the culvert and we jumped up on top of the road and noticed that there was a metal gate on the one end. So whatever was in the culvert was not coming out unless we opened the gate or scared it. So Herb and Ray was on the east side waiting, and Jerry and I jumped up on top of the culvert, and I said, Jerry, I says, crank open that culvert. And it was rusty and squeaky, and man, it squeaked as he started to turn it. And as soon as he started to turn it, out jumps a bobcat. And this bobcat seen Ray and Herb, and then it jumped up right 6 feet in front of me. And it humped up and started hissing and spitting and pawing the ground, and I pumped three shots into it as fast as I could. My brother Herb says, I didn't know you had an automatic. And I tell you, later Jerry says, well, weren't you just a little worried? And I says, I was worried. But we didn't make sausage out of him. We left him lay right there. But Jerry and I were very close. And more than brothers, we were friends. And when I failed, he would lift me up. And I remember a few years ago, I failed big time. And I was sharing this with Jerry at the table at their house. And he says, you know, Neil, he says, I don't think any less of you today than I did yesterday. And he says, let's pray about it. And we prayed about it, and I had total peace. But he was that kind and understanding. I never heard him really badmouth anybody. And whenever there was a need, LMA and Jerry was quick to respond. A neighbor across the street was sick and dying, and they visited him, and I think Jerry led him to the Lord before he died. And if somebody was in need of help, they were right there. And I so admired that quality in him. But I want to share a little bit with you about the last day. Jerry died a week ago last Wednesday, and I had visited with him almost every day before that, and he told me, he says, Neil, he says, the end is nearing. He said, he looked at me and he says, you know, Neil, he says, we all got to die. He says, God's got to make room for the next generation coming in. So he says, we got to step out of the way. And but he says, it's just awesome to think about standing before Jesus. And I'll be able to see the nail prints in his hand and the scar of the crown of thorns that he wore. And I'll be with him. And it reminded me, I got to the house about noon, and I sat by his bed, and he was barely awake. He could open his eyes with real effort. And I took his hand, and I rubbed his arm, and I told him I loved him. And he barely opened an eye, and he says, you know, he says, I love you too. And I sat there for probably an hour and a half, and every once in a while he'd say, Neil, are you there? I'd say, yes. And he could barely talk. His throat was filling up with phlegm, and I knew that the end was coming. It was not long, but he was so ready. He was so ready to meet the Lord. And then about 1:30 that day, Julie Cahoon, who was, and that was a miracle of God, Julie Cahoon was appointed to Jerry's case. And Julie and John Cahoon and their daughters and son used to live in the basement of Jerry's house. So Julie became a nurse, and here she was assigned to Jerry to take care of him. And man, I couldn't have been happier when I seen that. And she was so kind and understanding to him. And she took excellent care of him. And about 1:30, they showed up, and then I left the bedside. I hung around for an hour or two and went home. And then later that night at 9:30, he passed away. The struggle was over. And, you know, they had split Jerry open 6 times. They cut the sternum open. And one time, right after they cut the sternum open, they sewed him back up, and the next day he developed an infection behind the sternum. So they had to cut him open again. And they spread the sternum in order to treat the infection. And he laid like that on his back for over a week in the hospital. Never complaining, though. They just said it's uncomfortable, but that was about all. And he never hesitated to witness to doctors or nurses. And I told the group last night as we met as a family, I told about one surgery he had a year or two ago. They were all in the surgery room, the doctors and the nurses, and the anesthesiologist was about to put him to sleep. And he says, would you give me just a couple of minutes, or maybe even a minute? And they said, okay, what do you want to do? And he says, I want to pray. And so he prayed for the doctors and the nurses, and he quoted a scripture. He said, I don't even remember what the scripture was. But then he said, I looked at him, and I says, okay, you can put me to sleep. And they did, and they completed the surgery. And other doctors I know that he prayed with. He never hesitated to share his faith in Christ. And he considered every friend of his something very special. And he just reached out with a real attitude of love. In John, as I looked at Monday night, we had viewing of the casket, and as I looked at Jerry in the casket, and I thought about the streets of gold. You know, we pay $1,300 an ounce, and God uses it for asphalt in heaven. But in John 11:25, as I looked at Jerry, it was a verse from the account in John 11 when Lazarus died. And you remember the account how Jesus came and Mary and Martha were so upset, and they said, Lord, if you'd have been here, he would have never died. And then the shortest verse in the scripture was quoted, Jesus wept. And some say, well, he wept because of their unbelief. But I believe he related to their sorrow. He knew what it was like. And then he says, roll the stone away from the front of the grave. And they says, no, Lord, we can't. He's been dead for 4 days. And he says, roll the stone away. And then with a voice, with authority, he said, Lazarus, come forth. And Lazarus walked out of the tomb, wrapped in grave cloths, and they untied the grave cloths. And Mary and Martha rejoiced. What a miracle it was. But this is a verse that Jesus said. Jesus was talking to Mary and Martha. And Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. We make a transition from death unto life. It's like stepping through a doorway. And there is no death. You know, the scripture describes death as an enemy, and I could see that fight with the enemy in Jerry's last hours. But praise the Lord, he was victorious. And he was ushered into the presence of Jesus. In Romans 4:21, it says this, and being fully persuaded that what he had promised, he was also able to perform. So there was meaning. You can stake your life on what God says in His Word. It is the reservoir of all truth. Someone says, well, what is truth? Jesus says, I am truth. Read my word and trust what I say. The world has all kinds of answers. I just heard recently, in the city of Los Angeles alone, there's 450 people who claim to be Jesus Christ. So it's important to know God and His Word and to read it and to believe it and to put your trust in it. But I was so proud of Jerry. I could talk to him about the Bible, and he was heads and shoulders above me, and he could share truths that I had never seen before. And I so appreciated that. I lost a brother for a few days. I'm not far behind him, I know that. And one more thing I want to share, it just came to my mind. While I was sitting with Jerry, the title of an old Swedish gospel song came to me, and it was called Nearing the Shore. I don't know if you've ever heard that Swedish evangelist. He would come to America, this was in the 60s, and he would go all over the country preaching the gospel. He felt God wanted him to preach in America. Imagine that. We sent missionaries out from America. But he felt led from Sweden to come here. And he came and he had meetings in our little church on Strand Avenue. And I can remember him singing that song, Nearing the Shore. And then he told the story of how God led him to write those words. He said after he finished 4 or 5 months in the U.S., he headed back to Sweden. And the mode of transportation at that time was ocean liner. And when he got within about 10 miles of Sweden, his wife called him on the telephone. It was shore-to-ship phone and expensive. He says, I never reminded her of the cost. But she says, where are you? And he says, well, he says, we're quite a ways out yet. And they kept visiting, and then pretty soon she says, well, how close are you now? And he says, we're nearing the shore. And she says, well, can you see the buildings? He says, I can see the buildings, and I can see the people on the dock. And they're waving their arms, and some are jumping up and down, and they're shouting. And God encouraged him to write those words. I wish I knew the words. I don't. But it was about nearing the shore of heaven. And as I looked at Jerry, I thought, that day while he was still in his bed, he's nearing the shore. And on the other side, there's a group of people that's waving their arms. And they're shouting, he's coming. He'll be here. And his brother Marvin, who he loves so much, was there, his parents. Our other brothers and sisters that have died. But we're all nearing the shore. There's no guarantee of life. Youth is no guarantee. And it's important to know Jesus Christ. We all take pains to make reservations for our when we quit working. You know, we make investments and we make all kinds of savings accounts. But sometimes we fail to make the reservation in heaven and make preparations for the big retirement. That's eternity. It's going to last forever. And what we have here is going to be left behind. Have you ever seen a U-Haul behind the hearse? I have never. Maybe we will someday, but So thank you.
I love that song. I love it. I could listen to each of the previous speakers for a lot longer than they've spoken. They both, or they all, offered such richness to add to this time today. I really don't need to share anything. I'm going to share for only a few minutes because I believe that Jerry wanted me to do this. He told me so. I always listen to what Jerry said. Only some of it he wanted me to share. You know, many times in the last few months, I've been asked by various people, what do you know about Jerry? And while I was never fully sure what to say from one day to the next, some days he was feeling great, some days he was not. I always told people what I knew, and I would give them the latest update on what I had heard or what I knew personally. This last week, I was asked that question again. And this time, I was amazed at how much confidence I had in sharing an answer. What do you know about Jerry? Well, let me tell you, Jerry's finished his race. Jerry is with the Lord. The Apostle Paul spoke of being absent from the body and present with the Lord. The psalmist wrote, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. It's a good thing. Relationship continues. In fact, becomes immensely clear after death. I know this is not about me, but like some of you, whose experience was this as well, Jerry was like a father to me. We spoke openly about our love for each other. I remember rooming with Jerry in China for a few nights, and he spoke so openly about his love for Ella Mae and his love for his kids and their spouses and his grandchildren. We prayed at length together in those rooms where we stayed in China. And it was so refreshing always to be with him. I often told him that when I grow up someday, I'm going to be just like you. Not everything was spiritual with Jerry. I often thought of him as a wordsmith. He could turn a phrase or retrieve a saying like no one else. One time, he was speaking here at the church, and he said, and I quote, there once was a cowboy who got on his horse and rode off in all directions. And knowing that's impossible, it made me want to live a life of focus. A life lived on purpose, for a purpose. One time when we went out for pizza at lunch, as we often did, he concluded our time by saying, well, you ready to roll, Thunder? I knew it was time to go. I could have spent the whole afternoon with him. You know, Jerry didn't need to project an image. The man himself was a billboard for character and integrity and love of Jesus. And when I think of Jerry, I don't think of someone who served in scores of different ways. I probably asked him to be an elder a half dozen times over the years. Every time he said no. I think he did that for me so that we could have a relationship beyond a relationship with elders. But I remember the last time I asked him, I told him, I know you're going to say no, and I'm not going to ask you again after this year. I just said that if you ever want to be an elder, just let me know. And now I don't know why I ever asked him to be an elder. He was an elder, a statesman elder, by virtue of his life. And so, I don't think of all the ways that Jerry served over the years. I think rather of this one who maintained a vital connection with Jesus. He had this tremendous capacity to stay in step with the Holy Spirit. And I so admired that. He loved the Word of God. Jerry's life verses are 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 through 6. And he used those words, life verses, frequently. He'd use them as a springboard into conversation about the Lord. He would ask people if they had a life verse or if they knew what a life verse was. And they usually would say no. And he would go on to talk about that's a your life verse becomes a philosophy of life. It's a way of seeing life and organizing your life. And you conduct your life as though this is an anchor. Something solid. And he would confidently share his life verses. I want to read them to you. 1 Peter 1, verses 3 through 6. Listen to these. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade, kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you greatly rejoice, though now, for a little while, you have had to suffer grief in all kinds of trials. For many of us here today, those words are pure gold. If you've never heard those words before, they amount to this lavish news that God took all the responsibility upon himself to ensure that you could come into his family. You know, it's not a given that you are in God's family. You know, many in the world today believe that they're already in God's family simply by belief that God created them. But the truth is that God, in his great mercy, bore the responsibility himself to provide for you to come into the family. He did not place the onus on you to make yourself acceptable to him, contrary to what many believe. Rather, he put the weight of that responsibility on his son, Jesus, who came and who died, yes, but then conquered death, raised from the dead. The Bible tells us that Jesus is alive today. And that makes him a living hope for each one of us who believe on him. This is the good news. It's good to know that God has made provision through his Son. The way you come into God's family is to believe on Jesus. The Bible says in Romans 1:16, this gospel, that good news that I'm talking about, this gospel is the power of God for the salvation of everyone who believes. Believing is the way into God's family. Everyone who believes is included. Years ago, Jerry was speaking to our church, and he told the story of when he was a little boy, or a young boy. His mom As I remember the story, his mom said that they were all going to go out and do something together as a family. And Jerry didn't want to go, and so he stayed home. But while the family was on their outing or their adventure, a photograph was taken of all of them. And of course, it was framed. And for years, Jerry said, every time I looked at that photograph in the living room, I realized I was not in the picture. If Jerry could be standing here right now, I have every confidence he would say, oh, how I want everyone in this room to be in God's family picture. Provision has been made for everyone to be in the picture. Believe. Believe on Jesus. You'll never regret it. Will you bow your head with me? And in the quietness of this moment, in the privacy of where you sit, I want to give you an opportunity. Some of you have placed your faith in that Jesus. Some of you believe, perhaps others of you do not. You've never crossed that threshold. You've never come to that point in your life where you said, I believe. Jesus is now going to be the foundation of my life. I want to come into God's family. Right now, here today, in the quietness of this space, in the quietness of your own heart, you can say, I believe. Jesus is going to be my Lord. Jesus now is going to be my leader. He's my foundation. I place my trust in him so that I can be in God's family. Take that step today. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your gifts to us. Thank you for Jesus, who did not put the onus on us to make ourselves acceptable to you, but who took the burden upon himself. Thank you for Jesus. We love you, Lord. And Father, in these coming days where we recognize that Jerry is not immediately in our presence, this one who loved Jesus, Lord, our prayers and our support go to the family. Lord, we pray for Ella May especially. Lord, hear our prayers. Thank you, God, for your goodness to us. Thank you for this important time that we've had together today. Amen.
Let's stand and sing again together.
Bye.
want to thank all of you for coming today on behalf of the family. Thank you so much. And we want you to know that there's an opportunity in the adjacent room for a reception. And so we're going to allow for the family to leave at this time and meet you in the foyer or in that gymnasium for the reception time.